April 14th at 3 o'clock. I just would like to start off with something near and dear to my heart. When I was in high school, my dad often told me as I was leaving the house to go to school, he would often talk to me about this specific prayer, the Serenity Prayer. I don't know if many of you know about the Serenity Prayer, but this is on my desk, and I recite it every day. Its distribution is likely from a diary expert or excerpt from Dr. Reinhold's student, Winfrey Crane. And Winfrey placed the prayer in a newspaper article as historians account way back in the 1930s. And then in somewhat of an altered form in a book of worship in 1940. Over the years, there's been many, many different versions of the prayer that have been published, but the Serenity Prayer can be found in either a common short form or longer form, a full version with different languages that interprets the prayer. The most popular version is as follows, and this is the piece that I have actually on my desk. Goes a little something like this. God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. This well-known version was published in 1951. And this new one actually had one word in there with the word grace. The full version reads something like this. God, give me the grace to accept the serenity, the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things which I should change, and the wisdom to distinguish the one from the other. Living one day at a time, enjoying one moment at a time, accepting hardship as a pathway to peace. If I surrender to your will so that I may be reasonably happy in this life and supremely happy with you forever in the next. Amen. In my opinion, this Serenity Prayer it's a request. It's a request to God asking for calmness and peace in all matters of life. It asks for the strength and the courage to alter matters within a person's control and for acceptance in matters which cannot be changed. And ultimately, the prayer requests the ability to identify which circumstances are amenable to change. So from my desk to your living room, perhaps this time-tested prayer can help you in between those moments every day that we have now, looking for direction, understanding that debating and questioning factual matters are really of no helpful consequence and only results in confusion and unrest, but asking for God's help to discern wisely, that's a whole other level of judgment or clear-sightedness. We can prepare and make decisions based on logic and observation. So, like I said, from my desk to your living room, maybe this is one little prayer that can help you get through the day-to-day as we're all going through this situation together. The governor did not actually have a press conference this afternoon, so I have no updates from either the governor and or the Department of Health. Department of Health were sidetracked in a couple different directions this morning, so I didn't have a chance to talk with our Department of Health officials. I did want to talk about flattening the curve. And this is a little bit of a new topic or new data point within this topic. I still have, and I share this because many residents still have, a concern that flattening the curve is a misunderstood phrase. So many of you that are listening, either this live chat and or listening to the video here this evening, these next 5 minutes, hopefully you take away some little golden nuggets of it, even though many of us have either educated ourselves about what flattening the curve is, self-quarantining, social distancing. Many people have a clear definition and some people don't. So these next couple minutes are, again, another segment to try to clarify for folks what flattening the curve is. And the twist today is, over the last week, many of us at the Pinnacle Living Office and my colleagues around our organization, the executive directors, we found a website that makes the most sense to us to understand flattening the curve. If you would like to use this data at your own fingertips, I would encourage you to go on to www.covid19.healthdata.org, and you will be tuned into this specific website. Is Eddie out there? This graph up. Okay, sorry for that brief interruption. So this is the website, and it's the best website that we've been able to find to really chart what flattening the curve means. And so on the top left-hand side, you can still see that utilizing the data, which we're going to talk a little bit about what data means. It's not just confirmed cases that we're taking into account to understand what flattening the curve means. But in looking at all the specific data, we are still about 13 days away from Virginia reaching its peak. This pink area that you see down here, this bell curve, is a representation of what it would look like if there was no social distancing and or no self-quarantining and no stay-at-home executive order from the governor. That's what the peak would have looked like. But you can see that this dotted line here, you're able to push your mouse over top of this dotted line. And you can see, I'm going to go right over to the 14th today. You can see the number of, there's a lot of different data points that are taken into consideration to understand whether we're flattening the curve. It shows the total number of beds available within Virginia. It looks at the number of beds, the current bed availability for ICU, and it also takes into consideration the number of invasive ventilators that we're looking at that our healthcare system is utilizing. So when Dr. Fauci and Dr. Burke are talking about the data and all the modeling, we're not just considering confirmed cases and the unfortunate deaths that are occurring as a result of COVID-19. We're looking at hospitalizations, we're looking at emergency visits, we're looking at transfers to an ICU unit, we're looking at folks that are in ICU comparatively with those that actually need a ventilator. And those are most of the data points that are considered when we are modeling and flattening the curve. So I would encourage you to, if you have a computer, to again log into that website. It's probably the best website that that we have found to really help us understand where we're at with flattening the curve. The main point here about flattening the curve is it looks like, again, April 27th is the peak for this curve, this bell curve. That means we have to go through a down slope on this bell curve. We've been climbing this curve for the last 5 weeks, almost 6 weeks, and our peak is on April 27th. That means we had that amount of time on the downslope as well. So when the governor talks about an executive order to stay at home all the way through June 30th, there's a reason for that. And the reason is after we reach that peak, the down curve is also important because we're not out of the woods yet. The peak doesn't mean that this is over with, which I have come to the conclusion that many team members, many family members, and many residents are of the mindset that once we reach the peak, we're done with COVID-19. And that could be furthest from the truth. Thank you, Florence, for taking care of that camera. So again, I'm going to go backwards just a little bit here. And of course, technology is not working on my side right now. Okay, so there's that website again, www.covid19.healthdata.org. Hopefully you can navigate your way to that specific graph. Okay, with that, I'm gonna turn over the next 10, 15 minutes to a segment called Navigating COVID-19 with Dr. Amy Shear and Ann Hopper from our wellness clinic.
Some information that we give you in the past may not be, valid today. that will try and answer any questions you guys have. I will say that we don't have too many questions today, so if you want to call in with some, that would be just great.
And then the first thing we do want to say, we want to thank the families for being understanding with the restrictions that have been placed. We know it's hard on all of you, the residents, as well as the families not being able to visit. We hope with the phone, the computers, you're able to keep in touch.
Yeah, I think we've all gotten lessons on how to use Zoom and apps that we were never using before. We're getting better and better at it. I know with my family, we've been meeting every Sunday, and I have four brothers and a sister, so quite a large family, and we all get on Sundays and chat with my parents, and it's been interesting.
Right. You never thought that's the way you would be communicating. All right, well, I have a good first question. Canterbury Rehab has been on the news a lot, and they've had a rough go of it. So the question is, Dr. Scheer, what did Canterbury do wrong?
Well, I don't think necessarily that they did anything, that I know of wrong. I think that they were just one of the first places here that was hit, and they were unlucky. I think it's important to realize that a positive test in a facility doesn't mean that the facility did anything wrong. It just means that, the thing about this virus is that we don't have any immunity to it. Versus the flu, even if you've never had the flu, your body's been exposed to different elements of the flu through your life. So you have some antibody, some reaction to it to prevent you from getting it. Even if you didn't take the flu vaccine, 1 year to the next, even more so, you have an even better chance of not getting it if you did take that vaccine. We don't have any vaccines for this. Our body is naive to it. What that means is, if your body is exposed to it and it gets into your nasal passages, you will get it. You can have asymptomatic carriers, but they are positive for the virus. So it is different in that way. And so it's so easy for it to get in a place, and once it's here, it's very difficult to keep contained. So that's why, all this extremeness that we're going to with asking you to stay in your rooms, canceling all activities, 6 feet apart from everyone, the constant hand washing. It's more because we need to also get in the habit of doing that, because it could very easily be that tomorrow we may be positive, today we're negative as a facility. And so we want to make sure that all the practices are in place for that. So it's not necessarily that, right, just because a place has a positive test doesn't mean that they're a bad place. It just means that there was a positive there.
So when you said asymptomatic carrier, that means they're not showing any symptoms, but they actually have the virus in their system.
Right. Yeah. So, and I think that it's been surprising to me, even because I was kind of under the assumption that even as an older person, in an elderly population, because what we were hearing was, well, morbidity is so high and mortality is so high, I was under the assumption that everybody, 80 and up, if they had it, they would definitely have symptoms. We're finding that's not even the case, that there are some asymptomatic patients in their 80s that carry it, have, no symptoms at all, or very mild symptoms, so it's actually hard to catch, identify those people needing to be tested.
Right. That is tough. How long can this virus survive on surfaces?
So that's a good one. So on a hard surface, and that's most of what we're looking at, on the tops of things, or on plastic, it's 3 hours. So it can't be usually less than that, but the max it survives on surfaces is 3 hours. Now, there is some controversy because if it's in some liquid or, you know, there can be different mediums it's in, and I don't know all of that data.
Right.
But I also know even for, like, when we're talking about when we do a nasal swab, how long do they have to, you know, do we have to have the room be empty, and they're saying 3 hours, 1 to 3 hours, so. Go on the
mat
side of that always.
Right. Do I have to be so careful in my apartment with, say, hand washing or?
So, you know, yes and no. My thinking is that while, you know, you're unlikely to contract the virus from yourself if you don't have it, obviously there's no risk for that. I think it's just a good idea right now to be getting into the habit of frequent hand washing. So, I mean, I know for me, and Anna, I've talked to you about this, you know, because we're so careful about, you know, touch and, you know, keeping things sterile, whereas, you know, I have even noticed, like, shaking hands, it's so easy to shake a hand, and now, when somebody puts their hand out, I think to myself, no, I can't do that, right? Mm-hmm. Or, you know, when I'm listening to a patient's heart, you know, I didn't always rush to go clean it off right afterwards, and now I am, and I think that's because I'm getting into the habit, and we're all getting into the habit of making sure we're doing that with, you know, patients that I'm not, you know, concerned about. But if I'm doing that now, then I'm not gonna come across an asymptomatic patient and put that dirty, you know, hand onto my next patient. So I think if we're doing frequent hand washing, even if the only person we're exposed to is ourselves, that means we're gonna be that much more careful when we are out in public. So I think, you know, practicing those even when we're not, you know, when we are self-isolating, I think it's a good idea. And then if you're picking it up on surfaces and not even realizing it, then if you're doing frequent hand washing, if you're not touching your face, your eyes, your nose, your mouth, you know, then you're less likely, you know, you're just that much less likely to get it. So I think those are good habits to get into. So I would say keep hand washing even if you're only exposed to.
It's a good practice to get into.
Yeah.
All right. Here's a good one. Dr. Scheer, are you concerned coming onto our campus here, or your campus too?
You know, I must say that I feel like Cedarville is doing a very good job. And it was interesting to me this weekend. I probably had more anxiety going into Kroger than I do coming onto campus here, because I went, and I will never do it again during this, I went on a Saturday thinking, well, you know, I still work 8 to 5 on Monday through Friday, so Saturday was free, but there's nothing else going on. I'll go to the grocery store and do my grocery shopping. There were so many people in there. It was my anxiety level, because you look around and you're thinking, you know, I'm wearing a mask. I'm keeping alcohol on my hands. I'm trying to stay 6 feet apart from each other. But not everyone is. Mm-hmm. And you look around and you go, oh my gosh, there's, you know, it's not overrun, it's not what you were used to seeing before this, but I mean, there were 20 people in the produce section. So that's just, there's no way to be 6 feet apart. And so, you know, I think I'm way more exposed getting groceries, going through drive-throughs, to get fast food, I mean, just out in the community, because I think we're pretty kind of, I think there's lots of signs up here, there's alcohol stations, everybody's a little bit more aware, you know, people are wearing masks. I think in general, people are trying to do the right thing here. And so I actually feel more comfortable in a place like this, although I am more concerned with my population here, you know, I do not want to be the one to bring it in, and all of us feel that pressure. But I would say, like, outside of this area, people are not necessarily doing everything they should do. And I think that's probably more scared of that than, you know, showing up to work.
Right. I noticed too, some grocery stores now have like a one-way aisle, or they are limiting, not all of them, are limiting people coming in, so.
Yeah, and I think they're trying to do what, you know, they're supposed to do. I don't think that there's a store out there that wants to be accused of not practicing, you know, the ordinances. But I think that there are people out there that just rebel against it. And, you know, it doesn't take a whole lot of bad seeds to turn the whole thing upside down. So, I mean, that's, you know, I worry about that a little bit more. And I must say, you know, I will probably not go back to the grocery store on the weekend. I'll probably choose, you know, way early in the morning before I come in, or, you know, sometime in the afternoon and stay out and come back. But,
right.
You know, if that's, you know, if, again, I think, you know, I do the online ordering, and I'm a big advocate of, if there's one thing I could, if there's a trip I can eliminate, let's look into it,
right?
You know,
right.
So,
Dr. Shear, what do you do on the weekends besides going to the grocery store, which you won't be doing that again?
Well, it's hard sometimes. It is kind of boring out there right now. You know, I was thinking this was Easter weekend, and most of the time we would have, you know, my family and I would have gone down to Monument. We didn't have that this year, so. But we are doing some interesting things, like I made a pie based off of, you know, the questions last week. I made a pie for my neighbor and put it out on their stoop. And so then sometimes we've arranged where we meet out at 4:30 on Friday. Everybody sits on our porch and says hi to each other. That's helpful, just so that you can, A, see your neighbors, and then also just to kind of not feel so isolated, because it is very isolating. So, but I spend a lot of time, you know, with my daughter, and, you know, she's learning how to walk, and so it's really cute right now. It's a great stage for us. So, and then, you know, those video chats is good to keep up with family. And I try to do what I can to watch happy news. So I've kind of been, there's a couple of things on YouTube that are kind of funny, and kind of
amuse yourself or take your time.
And try not to watch too much television and too many Netflix, and try to get out of
that. Not the news,
because
you could watch that all the time, All right, how about this one? Should I continue with therapy, physical therapy, occupational therapy, even speech?
I would say more than ever, it's really necessary if you qualify for those services, because of just the social isolation and the distancing that we're doing, we are spending more time in front of the TV in our living room, rather than just our normal activities, you know, not going to the dining room, all of those things. You know, physical therapy and a therapist coming to us is actually, you know, they're practicing a lot of all the guidelines,
right?
Trying to wash their hands and keep covered and everything. So I think if I could get it for everyone, I would want to, just because that's, you know, something that's focusing on, you know, and I think our cognitive health is very important right now. What speech therapy often works on. And I think all of us should kind of try to do something to kind of exercise our brain as well as our bodies. So I think all of those things are very important right now.
All right. So how about this next one? I noticed there's a stop sign at Gatehouse, and our security guards are asking, where's someone going when they leave campus? And I know some people are thinking they need to meet their families, or they might be going to get something to eat, even though we have a meal delivered. What do you think about that, about them going out into the community still?
I think we're, again, there's a real importance here to do our part to kind of keep COVID away and let it just skip over this campus. I mean, I don't think I can pray that prayer enough. And I think that every time we leave and every time we come in, we risk getting it, and we risk our neighbors and our friends and everyone else getting it too. And I think that we need to be globally focused here. I think we need to kind of, I mean, as much as we might want to, and like I said, hey, Saturday, I thought, what else is going on in my house and what do I need to get done?
Right.
So I understand the desire to try and get out and to get off campus and to, you know, explore a little bit and not feel so confined. I get it. You know, I think we all get it.
Right.
But we need to think about our neighbor, and we need to think about, you know, those that can't self-isolate easily.
Right.
Those, you know, we have a lot of friends that, you know, we can't keep in their rooms all the time. We need to be doing what we can to keep them safe.
Right.
And part of that is doing our part. And our part is, you know, not traveling outside of campus unnecessarily.
Right.
And when I say necessarily, I mean really have a good reason. I mean,
right.
I think there needs to be, you know, more than just, I want to snack, or,
right.
You know,
or I want to go to the post office.
Yeah. And I think your families, I mean, I know that they want to see you. I want to see my mom and dad. You know, I think we all want to see each other right now. And I know that it's hard. But I also think that it's important to have those relationships and not have that physical right now, because it's not healthy for you, and it's not healthy for everyone else.
Right. Right.
Traveling right now is not a good option. Every person that your children are exposed to, now you're exposed to, now you're bringing back in for everybody else to be exposed to.
Right.
And I,
so what about when they say, well, I left with a mask and I have gloves on, and I was far away from people in the grocery store, or I saw my family. And we did it. Yeah, I went to my river house.
By yourself.
I should be fine.
I think, you know, it's one of these things that it's just, you're taking an unnecessary risk. You're also having to stop to get gas. I mean, I don't think you're able to go to the river. I mean, maybe, I don't know. Maybe you do go to the river and don't ever have to go to a grocery store or don't ever have to stop anywhere. But I think that isn't always the case. And I don't think that probably all river houses have enough groceries to last you every time you want to go there. And I think that, you know, it's just a time right now we're asking for sacrifice.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm acknowledging that this isn't fun. And I get that this isn't how we want to spend a beautiful day, you know. But I also think, I mean, just as much as, you know, I think I worry about coming here, I think we need to kind of take a look at where our priorities lie. And I think that it is important that we're looking out for each other right now.
Right.
And that we're making sacrifices for everyone's good, not just our own.
Right. It's like a blip in time right now.
Yeah.
Even though it feels like forever.
Right. Well, time is so much slower right now.
Right. Here's a question that came in. Should residents wear face masks here in Cedarfield?
Yeah, my thinking was is that if you have a mask available and or you've made one, I think it's a good idea because it kind of keeps, again, the thing with masks in general, I feel like the major influence they have is to keep you from touching your own mouth, your own nose, your own face.
Right.
And then also when you do sneeze or cough, it kind of you can see, there's plenty of videos out there where it talks about how much it soothes and distance, and with that mess, that's less. So it more protects other people from you. It's not the greatest for protecting you from, it's not, I don't want people to be so, put on a mask and think they're invincible, because it's not for that. And there's even advocates out there that say not to wear a mask because they think it makes people too confident and they get too close to each other and they get the virus. So it's not foolproof, but I think if you have a mask, it's a good idea, mainly so that, we're just isolating spread or decreasing that spread.
Right. It's basically both doing their parts, mm-hmm. once again. Yeah. Okay, another question. Purell, how long is it effective if you have just used it and you should touch a surface that could possibly have the virus? Am I safe? Good question.
Actually, Purell is pretty good. I remember when I was in microbiology lab, and you do the little petri dishes. I thought, this was when I was younger, so I think it was in high school, and we did one, and we went to the gym and the athletic area, and we took this nasty soap dish that just looked awful. And I thought, we're going to get a lot of bacteria growing on this, and we did it, and nothing grew. Because there were still remnants of soap that did take away the bacteria. And I think, sometimes if you're regularly putting Purell on, or Purell on the surface, yes, you do have to wait for it to absorb, 5-10 seconds. It doesn't need to dry, but at that point, it would take away what's on there currently. Everything's in moderation, right?
Exactly.
Yeah. If you touch something that has it on there, we'll know really to wash the surface there. But you probably are pretty good if you're constantly, and if you're putting,
right, and then I think it gets back to if you Purell your hands, not touching your face, right? Because then you're in your vicious cycle.
I've actually seen that there was a demonstration that I understood with, I think the worst you could do is put on gloves and then think that you're fine.
We do have people wearing gloves.
Yeah, so what I saw was, and it was a really good demonstration, was a nurse put on gloves and then she said, okay, so I go to the grocery store because I think I'm good because I have gloves on. And then she said, so I touched some things and oh, there's some virus on my gloves. Well, then I answered my phone and then I had to pay and I got my keys out to get my car and then I took my gloves off. So what all surfaces now have it all over and common surfaces that you use now has it over. Right. So that's was one of the points that she was making, was that a lot of times you put those gloves on and then you think, okay, I can't get it because I got gloves on my hands, and yet you're touching everything. It's almost better not to have the gloves because then you're thinking, I need to wash my hands.
Right.
And you're actually better off washing your hands than you are wearing the gloves because of that natural tendency to reach in your pocket and grab something, and then you've got your gloves on. So you really, it's
right, a false sense of security. But washing your hands is as good as using your Purell too.
Yes.
Sometimes
yes.
Using Purell is because you don't have the soap and water.
Right, yeah. And actually, I'm a big advocate of washing your hands because there's certain other bacteria out there that don't do, that hand washing is actually preferable to the alcohol wraps. So I have to wash my hands quite frequently.
Okay. We good? All right. We'll see you
next time.
Good, good. Thank you, Dr. Scheer and Ian Hopper. This next little segment has to do with the families. Those of you that are listening tonight after 5 o'clock here at Ricosta, a little family update. Tomorrow is Wednesday, and so we will pick back up our supplies shuttle program off of Gaskins and Maynard. So those of you that have loved ones living in the cottages, feel free to provide one brown bag of supplies that folks would need in the cottages. There was a rumor going around the community, not only here, but the community in general, that Cedarfield was allowing up to 5 bags per family for this shuttle program, and I just want to squash that rumor. We only have capacity to drop off 1 bag, so tomorrow's for the cottage residents. If you have any supplies, we appreciate you adhering to that 1 bag rule. We would be greatly appreciative. Again, families can go on to mycedarfield.com. Once you're in that specific website, if you go into, this will be the next page, if you click on the guest access, which is highlighted in that arrow below, you'll be guided to a web page that looks a little something like this. And the 3 icons to the left are those 3 main icons that you would want to use to get information here about Cedarfield and our preparedness plans. A couple of questions did come in after Dr. Scheer and Ann Hopper just left. One question was, do all the staff every day get checked for COVID-19? And the answer is no. We do not go through that protocol to check every team member for COVID-19. In fact, there probably isn't any hospital or long-term care setting that doesn't have any cases that goes through that protocol. We have no known COVID cases at Cedarfield at this point. So any other questions that came in, Renee, that we can ask? There's a couple more. Just as a little snapshot into the next couple of days, tomorrow I'm going to talk a little bit more about our preparedness plans and how our preparedness plans have evolved. There's a couple of entities that we're working with, Canterbury Nursing Home, and we have a copy of their lessons learned. And so the team has been combing through that lessons learned document today. And I'll give you a little snapshot of what we learned from our friends over at Canterbury. So we'll go through some evolving preparedness plans here at Cedarfield. And Matt will talk a little bit about life on the licensed areas, Sunshine Plaza, Assisted Living, and the Health Center, going a little bit beyond just the preparedness plans, but give people a comfort level of what's happening on the licensed side. And then Friday, yours truly will come back and talk a little bit about financial health and the marketplace economics. One question came in, is it okay just to start my car, drive it around the campus so that my battery is charged? And the answer is absolutely yes. If you would like to leave your cottage or your independent living apartment or your assisted living apartment and drive your car around campus to make sure your battery is working, that is absolutely okay. Okay, seeing no other questions. Again, we have no COVID-19 cases at this time. I just wanna stress, although we've been saying that for 5 weeks now, it doesn't mean that we're doing things right or wrong. We do have a very healthy, fluid preparedness plan in check. We are constantly monitoring residents, especially on the license side, with surveillance of fever or and or change of condition. We have a daily checklist that every resident goes by. So while we don't have any COVID-19 cases at Cedarfield at this time, this is a community-wide virus. As I just showed earlier, the www.covid19.health data, it shows that spike in cases in Virginia climbing to about 20,000 over the next several weeks. And so it's a community-wide virus, and we all have a role in being part of the solution. If for one moment throughout the day you feel like, you know, you're really unsettled, I would encourage you to say the Serenity Prayer. It's one of my favorites. God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. With that, I'm going to turn it over to Florence, is here today, Florence Brooks, for some spiritual help.
Great. Michael, I have a question for you before you go.
Yes.
You know, you had the question about all the staff being tested. Can you share with anyone about the screening that happened at the gate?
I think we did share a little while ago, but I guess it's always helpful to say it a few times.
Yeah.
So every team member, once they arrive at the gatehouse, not only team member, but every agency person and every private duty personnel, they are screened at the gatehouse, given the 7 questions that the CDC is recommending that everyone use. And every team member is given a temperature check as well.
Great, thank you.
Thank you, Florence.
And thank you, it's so good to be with you again this afternoon. I want to share with you another prayer, a well-known prayer, as part of our closing today. This prayer was discovered in 1915 in Normandy on the back of a prayer card of St. Francis. It's a prayer that you will recognize. It became known as the Peace Prayer of St. Francis. It's not actually known that St. Francis wrote it, but because of it being found on the back of that prayer card and being attributed to St. Francis, it's been passed down and known as that. So this afternoon, I'd like to close with this prayer. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is error, truth. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. And where there is sadness, joy. O Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned. And it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen. Thank you.